So, hello everyone. So, I'm going to continue where I stopped yesterday. And so maybe you remember the last thing I told you was about how to calculate retarded Green's functions in strongly coupled systems. And so I showed you this diagram of black hole. When in this direction, this is the distance from the singularity, and this is time. And so then the black hole is given by these horizons. So really, the black hole is here in the sense that anything which crosses this line will go to the singularity in the future, so it cannot come back. But on the other hand, on the other side, there's something called a white hole. So this is just the inverse of a black hole. This is this triangle here, so where everything has to come out but cannot come back. And then if we look at the source coupling to this operator, then the source traveling to the future and falling into the black hole, this will be the retarded Green's function. And on the other hand, the other causal possibility of something coming from the past and meeting the boundary there, this will be giving rise to the advanced Green's function. And so most importantly, some energy will fall into this black hole, and then it will be removed from the field theory. And so there's some dissipation which is going to take place. OK, and then I showed to you how to generalize the calculation I showed for the t equals to 0 case yesterday. So here you take the Klein-Gordon equation in this ADS black hole space. And if you insert the metric, then this is the differential equation which you get. And then you expand asymptotically near the boundary. And so the leading term will be the source. And then the subleading term will be the wave of the operator. And from this, you can calculate the two-point function, the retarded two-point function. OK, and essentially, the eigenfrequencies of small fluctuations, they will determine the poles of the retarded Green's function. So both their location and also the width of the associated spectral function. OK, so then this gives us these beautiful curves. And I will come back to them slightly later in the talk when I have given you more details. So to really understand these plots, I have to tell you how to introduce quarks into ADS-CFT. And this I haven't done yet, so, but this is the plan for today. So this, I will come back to this later. OK, so since there will be quite a few talks next week about hydrodynamics in ADS-CFT, I thought I should briefly mention this to you. So the idea is to describe essentially the quark-gluon plasma as a fluid. And so I think this is the first example which I'm really showing you in detail. And also, it's a very, very nice example because you start from something in supergravity and string theory, and there's a calculation of a result which you can then actually measure for the quark-gluon plasma. And so essentially, in this paper, it was shown that by calculating the two-point function of the energy momentum tensor, just in the way as I showed to you, I will do this in a second for you, then there's this quantity called the shear viscosity over the entropy density. So what's the shear viscosity? So imagine you have two plates, and you have some fluid in the middle between them. And then when you move one of the two plates, then obviously the fluid is also going to move. But the further you go inside, the slower it's actually going to move due to the fact that it's a viscous fluid. So, and this means there will be a gradient of the velocity in this direction. And the coefficient of this gradient is actually the shear viscosity. And so, as was shown in this paper, I mean, the fluids described by ADS-CFT are kind of the most strongly coupled fluid you can imagine, because the Tuft coupling really is infinite in this case. And so this really provides a universal lower bound, which does not depend on the details of the theory on this ratio. And so here you get this extremely small number. So 1 over 4 pi is 0.08. So if you think of water or helium or so, liquid helium, this quantity will be a factor 100 or even a factor 1,000 bigger. And it's also very universal because it only depends on these natural constants, so H bar and K Boltzmann. And okay, so the essential point is to divide by the entropy density to get a quantity which scales in these nice units. And so that's where you get this universal result. Okay, so this bound is then satisfied by the most strongly coupled systems. So in our case, lambda goes to infinity. And so what is very nice about this, that this bound actually has been measured, well, at least it has been confirmed by measurements of for the quark plasma at the Rick accelerator in Brookhaven. And so now nowadays, actually, and there's quite a few people thinking about whether this can also be studied for electrons in a solid. So in a solid, of course, fluids are much more complicated to obtain, but there's a lattice and there's impurities, and so there are many more things to scatter. But there's some experiments actually which show that even the electrons in the solid can be described by such a hydrodynamic fluid. And then, of course, one can also investigate this bound. Also for cold atoms, I think there are results which are compatible with this bound. Okay, so this is a very important result of ADS-CFT. So let me explain to you how this is calculated, and we can do this with the methods which I explained to you yesterday. But first, to do that, let me briefly explain a few facts about hydrodynamics which we will need for this. So what's hydrodynamics? Well, essentially, it's an effective field theory where you consider the limit of long wavelengths and low frequency fluctuations in a fluid. And so the idea is to expand all the physical quantities and derivatives of the fluid velocity. Okay. So, and this can, well, of course, this is available for non-relativistic fluids, but it can also be done relativistically. And the shear viscosity actually appears in the hydrodynamic expansion for the energy momentum tensor, so which contains information about the energy density and energy and momentum flux. Okay, so essentially, what we do is we take our energy momentum tensor, and then we expand it to first order in derivatives. And so it's actually found that to lowest order, so there's a term containing the four velocity u, and which is normalized in such a way, actually. And this is the energy density and the pressure, and this is the metric. And then to first order in this expansion, so you see first order means that we see one derivative appearing in each of these terms. We have two transport coefficients. One of them is the shear viscosity, and the other one is the so-called bulk viscosity. Sorry, I couldn't hear what you said.
Compared to what?
Yes.
I mean, long wavelength fluctuation in the fluid. Long compared to what? So what are...
Well, it means so long that you can actually make a meaningful expansion like this. Okay, well, okay, there's certainly the mean free path is a scale which you have in your theory. So, okay, I guess I would say long to the mean free path maybe is so. Okay, so and you see here, there's the bulk term, and so which the bulk term has a trace here, and this is the off-diagonal terms. Now, in a conformal field theory, the trace of the energy momentum tensor vanishes, so this means there is no bulk viscosity. So then, of course, the shear viscosity is the quantity at hand which we want to consider. Okay, and so how is this calculation performed? So yesterday I explained that you can have operators which are dual to particular sources. And yesterday I gave the example of a scalar operator dual to a scalar field. But you can also consider the energy momentum tensor in your field theory, which is then dual to the graviton, just by the fact that it's also a rank 2 tensor, which is symmetric in its indices. And so the idea is now to calculate the correlation function just with this method I explained to you yesterday. And I reminded you, so using precisely this method. Okay, so now here we put the energy momentum tensor, and then we consider a graviton propagating here. And so then we calculate the correlation function of the energy momentum tensor from the propagation through the black hole space. And so that's where ADS-CFT enters. And then the shear viscosity is obtained from the so-called Kubo formula. So the Kubo formula is something just in many body theory or in this hydrodynamic expansion. And it just tells you how you get this coefficient eta, so the shear viscosity, once you know what the retarded Green's function is. But the retarded Green's function for this energy momentum tensor correlator, you get precisely in the way I just outlined to you. Okay, so then essentially you use this ADS-CFT computation and inserted it here. I mean, this formula is valid much more generally, and you could also insert the Green's function calculated, say, at weak coupling in a different way. But then, of course, you would get a different result. Okay, and precisely this calculation gives you this result. So there's pi n squared, n is the rank of the gauge group again, T is the temperature. And so then also you can calculate the entropy density for your black hole just from the area of the black hole, essentially. And that's the result which you get in, from the area of the black hole horizon. So, and then the ratio of the two gives precisely this famous result, which I showed to you on the previous transparency. Okay. So ADS-CFT really provides you with this coefficient. I mean, this depends on the coefficient on the parameters H or on the constants H bar and K Boltzmann. This you could also infer from the fact that this is actually a so-called quantum critical system.
A very quick question. The formula for the shear viscosity is eta equals pi n squared t to the 3 over 8 and also the entropy density. This n shows up, but I guess this computation is performed in the weak form of ADS-CFT where we send basically n to infinity. So how does this n pop up here?
Okay. You have to be very careful. I mean, of course, n is very big. But still, this means that it enters as a prefactor in your calculation. So it just, if you write down the gravity action which you have to use to do this computation, then there's a G Newton. It's the Einstein-Hilbert action, so it involves a G Newton. And this G Newton, if you calculate it, translate it into the quantities of ADS-CFT, like the ADS radius and so on, then this n will appear.
Okay.
So, I mean, okay, it's a good question. So, but of course, that's one reason why one looks at this coefficient, because that's independent of n then. But so when I say large n limit, it always means I look at the leading order. And the leading order goes with this n squared. And so it just means that any 1 over n corrections to this will be absent.
Okay, so this means that the quotient eta over s is only independent of n in the leading order, right?
Yes, that's, well, yes.
Okay.
I guess that's true, yeah.
Question. This calculation did not involve quarks. Does it, did it involve quarks also? Or only?
Okay, so this calculation is just done for an AdS Schwarzschild black hole. But later people found that it's actually a universal result in the sense that if you add other matter to your gravity action, it does not influence this leading order result. So in that sense, it's a universal result. So you can put extra matter, but since, okay, so it's really a rather simple calculation. Anything that enters is just this two-point function of the energy momentum tensor in the dual field theory, but that's just dual to the graviton. So the graviton is essentially just determined by the geometry. And so that's one of the particular interesting universal features, that this doesn't depend on the matter content of the gravity action. Yeah, okay, that's what I just tried to explain. So this is actually done in this kind of bottom-up computation. So it's just using the gravity action in five dimensions. But the amazing thing is that this is a universal result. It doesn't depend on what other terms, I mean, you put in the gravity action. But of course, it's true that this is a leading order infinite coupling approximation, and but this is the key feature of this result, that it's really universal. So the statement is that if you take infinite coupling, this is what you're going to get. Now, okay, this is not 100% true, because people have found some models where there's some corrections which even violate this bound. So that if you go take some 1 over n corrections, for instance, or it might even be smaller than this number. So, okay, there's some caveats, but I think what I said to zeros order is correct too. Yes, but the statement is they don't show up in this result. They just decouple. Yeah, so this is very important. So if you add any quarks or so, they will decouple and not affect this result. Okay. So everything I'm saying is to zeros order. I mean, as I said, there are some models where there's violations of this, where it has been shown that there can be violations of this bound. Another thing is what you could do so this really strongly depends on rotational symmetry. So one paper I wrote about 10 years ago is to switch on a kind of P-wave condensate. Then that breaks rotational invariance, and then actually this coefficient starts to depend on the temperature. But so then it's not in the universal anymore. In our case, though, it's still satisfied the bound. Okay, so there's still some debate when exactly this bound is satisfied and when it's broken and so on. But okay. I think to zeros order is fair to say that it's a universal bound. It doesn't depend on the microscopic details of the theory. However, of course, if you look at corrections, you know, there can be violations. There can be behavior. Okay, but I think it's fair to say it's not 100% understood when exactly this bound is valid. I mean, if there's no necessary conditions, which I mean, I'm sure this should be able. One should be able to write down these are necessary conditions which you have to satisfy to violate this bound. But I don't think this is written down somewhere in the code. That would be interesting to do, actually.
So this is dimension independent. It's true in any dimension?
Yes, that's another interesting feature. It's true in any dimension. Yeah. Yeah, so in that sense, it's really universal. Okay, so and the measurements that Rick for jet quenching, they're consistent with liquid, which means that the quark gluon plus bar is a very strongly coupled liquid, which is a very non-trivial statement. Okay, so just following up on this, let me show you another transport coefficient, which we looked at about 11 years ago. Sorry. And So now what you can also do is, instead of looking at the shear viscosity, is looking at a particular vorticity coefficient. I think along this week somebody mentioned, I think Rob in his talk mentioned the chiral magnetic effect. And what I'm going to tell you here is a kind of cousin of the chiral magnetic effect. Okay, and again, it's very similar in spirit to the shear viscosity, because we start from an action in supergravity. So in this case, we take, okay, essentially, these words are all written there just to impress you, okay? It's really a well-defined action in 11-dimensional supergravity. And then there's some compactification on 6 dimensions. Then, so if you start with 11 dimension and compactify on 6, then you get something in the 5 dimensions. So then we get this action. So this is the Newton constant in 5 dimensions. So this is the Ricci scalar. This comes from the negative cosmological constant of anti-de Sitter space. And then we consider a U1 gauge field here on the gravity side. And this has this 5-dimensional Chern-Simons term here, okay? So it's a parity breaking action because we have a Chern-Simons term here. And so this compactification ensures that this is corresponds to a supersymmetric theory, and then this means that this coefficient 1 over 2 times square root 3, this is actually fixed by supersymmetry, okay? Okay, and now, we can do an analysis of the dual field theory actually there's some interesting fact, which is that this Chern-Simons term leads to an axial anomaly for the boundary field theory. So one important fact about ADS-CFT is that if you have a gauge field on the gravity side, it's actually dual to a global symmetry on the boundary. Okay, so, and this means if we have a U1 gauge field on the gravity side, then we get a U1 global symmetry at the boundary. So there's a U1 axial current. And you can show that this action implies that you reproduce the standard well-known U1 axial anomaly, or the one you find also for the decay of a pion into 2 photons. And this takes this form. Okay, so this is known years in quantum field theory, but the ADS-CFT calculation reproduces this result. Sorry. Which is due to the fact, okay, so that essentially, again, this coefficient doesn't depend on lambda. It's a one loop coefficient which is, doesn't get renormalized. So now what you can do is, so if you can't just have a, well, you can have a hydro expansion of the energy momentum tensor as I showed to you, but you can also have a hydro expansion of this axial current, just the same way. So we expand this current in derivatives of the velocity. And so this anomaly will then actually contribute to this hydrodynamic expansion. Okay, so to lowest order and to zeroth order, you just have, so this is a U1 current, so there's a U1 charge. So this is just the U1 charge multiplying the 4 velocity. And then there will be also parity preserving contributions with just one derivative of the velocity. And then there will be this term, which involves this particular expression. So this comes from that. And so that's a vorticity. And so if you go to the rest frame of the fluid, it just takes this form. So I think there was some renewed interest. I mean, some people who were working on the quark-gluon plasma, they should know much better than me. So there was some renewed interest of vorticity. And so in view of this renewed interest, this is certainly very interesting. I should emphasize that this is a local vorticity, which you define at every point in space. So then maybe it's a little harder to get this experimentally, but okay.
Sorry, when you say that this chance moment term break this divergence, this gives rise to an anomaly.
Yes, yes, exactly. So,
but shouldn't there be an imprint that there should be some parameter sitting in front of chance moments which appears here? I mean, so how do you know this precisely coming from the chance moments term?
Okay, it's a slightly longer calculation, but you can show that this coefficient here is consistent with this anomaly there. I mean, okay, I'm going fast. I'm not showing all the steps of the computation, but okay, there's some well-defined prescription how you get from an ADS gravity to a fluid hydrodynamic expansion. This is something which goes under the name of fluid gravity correspondence, and it is fluid gravity correspondence tells you how to get this expansion from your gravity action.
What I'm asking is that should there be some coefficient in front of the Chern-Simons terms which also appears in this del mu j mu relation such that
I didn't finish explaining it. So this is the expression you get in quantum field theory, and I said that this term is consistent with that. But also this method of fluid gravity gives you a relation between this term and this psi. Okay, so it's the same as before. I mean, if you go back to the shear viscosity, you know, first I defined it for you here, and then I said the calculation gives 1 over 4 pi. Okay, so here's just the definition. So this equation for the J is equivalent to this equation. Okay, and then, I said, okay, now we calculate the Cooper formula, and then we get this result. Okay, and the same you can do here. So here this is the hydrodynamic expansion, and then you can say now I take this action and calculate the Cooper formula, and then I get a result for this psi. It's slightly less universal than, okay, the nice thing about the shear viscosity is that by dividing by the entropy density you get this very universal quantity. But since the vorticity is of a different dimension, yeah, you can't just divide this by some variant of the entropy density and get something equally universal. So it's very nice, it's very similar, but it's not quite as universal as the other one. Well, I mean, this is also something one could study. I mean, can we extract a universal quantity from this? Yeah.
Zeta relate to this? Sorry, not zeta, xi. Yeah.
Xi is the analog of eta in the expansion of the current. So before I was expanding the energy momentum tensor. Okay, so let me show this again. So I said expand physical quantities in derivatives of the fluid velocity. So on this slide, I took the energy momentum tensor and I expanded in derivatives of the velocity. And the coefficients are called xi, eta and zeta in this case. Okay. Now, this equation is just exactly the same, except I'm doing this for a charged current, U1 current. And then, okay, there's other terms which I didn't write, which preserve parity, so and also and contain a gradient of the velocity. But at first order, you also get this time, you see, so there's one derivative here. So it's first order and derivatives. But this is a totally standard, well, it's parity breaking, but it's a totally standard covariant term. Okay, and then in the next step, you can now go ahead and calculate this psi from this gravity action. Okay, but this is a long calculation, and I'm not going to show you because it's not quite as dramatic as the other one, because I can't just divide by S and get something universal. But in principle, it's exactly the same structure. And I think given the fact that people are now interested in vorticities again in quark-gluon plasma, it would be, okay, you see this was from 11 years ago. It would be nice to go back to this and understand some more, if we can write this in something.
In that sense, it's equivalent to eta, you are saying?
Yes. It's the same as the eta, except for a charge current, not for the energy momentum tensor. Yeah. Okay. But even if you don't calculate exactly from fluid gravity, but which we can, but I'm not going to show you because it's long and not so revealing. So So actually, when we wrote this paper, then there's a little later there was this paper by Son and Surovka, and they predicted that this vorticity should have a rather dramatic effect on the quark-gluon plasma, and something called chiral separation. So the chiral separation means that if you have a volume of rotating quark matter, then the quarks of opposite chirality move in opposite directions, which then goes under the name of chiral vortical effect. So assume that there's a heavy ion collision, and so we have these two pancakes arriving, and they don't hit centrally, they hit at some distance from each other. And certainly what's going to happen if they hit this way, it's going to spiral. Okay, it's going to turn, and you get an angular momentum. And then, so this anomaly term which is there then means that the left-handed and right-handed quarks or particles in the system, the left-handed ones, they will move along the angular momentum, and the right-handed ones, they will move in the opposite direction. Okay. It's not super easy to realize this experimentally, because you have to make sure that this anomaly is actually there. So you need a topological charge or a so-called axial chemical potential in your quark-gluon plasma background. And I mean, some people argue that this is actually there in this scenario. And so there's this axial chemical potential, which is associated to the difference in number of left and right-handed fermions. So once you have this parity breaking background present in your QCD matter, then there's a proposal for an experimental confirmation of this effect, which is that you should see an enhanced production of spin excited hadrons along the rotation axis. And now, given there's this renewed interest in vorticity, maybe I think this is not so easy to measure, but okay, I think there were some measurements in this direction last year, and maybe this is something to, yeah, recent also this year. Or? Yeah, I'm aware of that, but I'm not sure they were able to resolve exactly this effect here. I think it's one step before actually coming to this. But yeah, building on this, maybe this is something to look for. That would be very interesting. Okay, but again, you know, this is something where you start with a string theory action. And so one slide later, we start talking about experiments. Okay, so this is kind of interesting, kind of from a science philosophy perspective. Okay, I start with something really mathematical and not really designed for the real world, but then one slide later, I can ask, can we see this in experiment? So this is super interesting. I mean, this is why I like ADS-CFT. You can start with something super abstract and then very quickly come to measurements. Okay. Okay. So there's a cute side remark about this. Right. So there's a cute side remark in the sense that this chiral separation is, of course, a relativistic quantum effect. So actually, when we first did this calculation, let me go back. So as I said, you know, this was done in this paper in 8 years ago. 11 years ago, and then slightly later, Son published this paper, the chiral separation. So in some sense, this is related to the chiral magnetic effect, because in the chiral magnetic effect, you just replace this angular momentum with a magnetic field, and then things start moving along the magnetic field. But anyway, so Son knew our paper, and then I met him at some conference, and you know, he got his PhD in Moscow, and so apparently for people who did their PhD in Moscow, Landau and Lifshitz books are still kind of the Bible. Okay, so he told me, you know, this can't be true because your coefficient, so this psi, this is not written in a book by Landau and Lifshitz. So You know, it can't be there. Okay. Okay, one answer to this question is that this anomaly was found in 1969 in the book by Landau and Lifshitz on hydrodynamics and was written in 1955. Okay, so they have a good excuse for not writing about it. But then, of course, he started thinking about it himself, and then he said to me, "Yeah, look, what your result really means if this psi is non-zero. Okay, so here you have this rotating quark matter. It means the following: so if you put sugar into your coffee, so there's left and right-handed sugar molecules. Okay, and this chiral separation effect really means that if you start stirring your coffee, then the left-handed sugar molecules should jump out of your cup." Okay. That's really, so that's what someone said to me. He said, "Your effect can't be true because this is what you should see." But of course, we should remind ourselves that this is a relativistic quantum effect. So if you start rotating your coffee with relativistic velocity, also the whole coffee is going to come out of your cup, and then you can't observe the effect. Okay, but it's a nice analogy, and but this led Swan to write this beautiful conjecture about this chiral separation effect, and as this shows, it's a pretty dramatic, non-trivial behavior. So maybe this can be seen experimentally, which would be super interesting. Okay, good. So now let's move to other nice things. Okay, yeah, this is just a side remark since I started talking about hydrodynamics. I think later in the program there will be a lecture by Christian Ecker on some non-equilibrium behavior in ethnography. And this is also a very interesting aspect of ADS-CFT. So I won't say anything about it now, just mention that it exists. So you can also consider time-dependent solutions in gravity, like shock waves or collapsing matter shells. And this then describes, I mean, the idea is that it's dual to the equilibration process in the quark-gluon plasma. So after, you know, so the quark-gluon plasma forms when you collide these heavy nuclei, then of course there's some very non-equilibrium state, but this will relax in some way to the quark-gluon plasma. And so, because everything is very strongly coupled, both the thermalization time, also the time after which you can apply hydrodynamics will be very short to, compared to all other timescales in the problem. And I think Christian will tell you some more about this on Monday. Okay, another concept which I would like to mention very briefly. So I really want to spend the rest of my lecture talking about introducing quarks in quite some detail, but before I start with that, I would like to mention these couple of concepts. And another very, at the moment, very much studied concept in ADS-CFT is entanglement entropy. Okay, so let me explain very quickly what this is and why it's so interesting. And I think this is also, I mean, at the moment, this hasn't been studied in QCD so much, but I think this is also something for the future. Where probably we can extract some new information about QCD. Okay, so let me just explain what entanglement entropy is. So essentially you consider some region of space, which is this gray rectangle, and then you consider a subregion A, say, which is the circle. And the complement of A will be B. Okay, then you can define something called the von Neumann entropy, which essentially is built on the density matrix for the whole system. And now this entanglement entropy is a concept which arises from introducing the so-called reduced density matrix. And this reduced density matrix means you associate a matrix to this region A by taking your total density matrix, which appeared there, and then you trace over all the states which are in this region B. Okay. That's a little bit like being outside a black hole where you don't know what's inside. Okay. And then this trace, of course, hides some information from you. And then the entanglement entropy, which is a measure how much the states in A and B are entangled, is then just the von Neumann entropy for this reduced density matrix. I will explain more details on the next slide, but let me say first that there was some very important work by two Japanese physicists, Ryu and Takayanagi, in 2006, where they suggested that there's a gravity dual of this quantity. And so what they conjectured was that this entanglement entropy is actually the dual theory. So now we add an extra dimension. Sorry. So we add an extra dimension. This is our anti de Sitter radial direction. And then we can build a surface on top of just this boundary between A and B. And then, well, we can calculate the area of the surface. And there will be a minimal area which is dictated by the curved metric in this xy direction, actually. And then the conjecture of Ryu and Takayanagi is that, they conjectured that the gravity dual of this entanglement entropy isn't given by the area of this minimal surface, which shares this boundary here between A and B at the boundary. So, and that's been a very, very successful proposal, and there's a huge amount of work which followed this paper. Okay. Just to give slightly more details. So if you remember from your quantum mechanics or statistical mechanics course, so the density matrix is given by this expression here, where these psi n are some states in the Hilbert space. And as I said, the von Neumann entropy is then just given by this expression where this is your density matrix. And then you can see that when rho is diagonal, then this is maximized. So when it's diagonal with equal entries, it's maximized. And also it vanishes for pure states, because for pure states, rho squared is equal to rho. Okay. Okay, so so then we can see that there will be a very nice measure for entanglement which follows from this. So now, instead of just considering two space-time regions like here, you could more abstractly consider a product Hilbert space. So say you have a Hilbert space spanned by these vectors psi, and you can factor this into two parts. Okay? And then that's the more general definition. So this is exactly the same definition I wrote before. So here I just wrote this for the case when the Hilbert spaces are just two separate regions in space, two regions separated in space. But you could do this more generally for some general Hilbert space. Okay, and as I already mentioned, there's an analogy to the black hole entropy, because you could think that A is kind of outside the black hole and B is inside the black hole. So then you lose some information about what actually happens inside the black hole. Okay, and here's again a picture of this Ryu Takayanagi conjecture. And so it was checked that this, so again, this is a conjecture in ADS-CFT, but there were many non-trivial checks. In particular, this quantity satisfies a number of inequalities. It's, for instance, this so-called strong subadditivity, which is this relation, which this entanglement entropy should satisfy. So on general grounds, you can show that this quantity has the properties which it should have. But you can also calculate it for some examples explicitly. And this is also a very non-trivial test of the ADS-CFT course. Yeah, sure.
I've heard people like Ning Bao and others discuss this, and it It looks kind of trivial, but evidently it's not. Could you just elaborate? I mean, you know, AUB is the whole, the union is the whole thing. And
what you mean, so elaborate on this? Right, okay, so it's just a formal relation. It's just a math, okay, so this is a mathematical property which entanglement entropies in general should satisfy. And then also this gravity expression satisfies the same relation. And I mean, well, yeah, this, I don't know what you define as trivial. I mean, it's not. But this is our first check which this quantity should pass. And
okay, well, in particular, what I remember him talking about is that in holographic models, you saturate the bound, that it's a strict equality.
Is it? Okay.
At least in the examples he discussed.
Okay. Well, then you know more than me. I mean, I just wanted to mention this as a fact that this quantity already as a kind of at a kind of abstract level satisfies the quantities which you know from static quantum statistical mechanics, which is satisfied. This can be that this is saturated for particular holographic models. Okay, what I wanted to show you is to discuss some particular examples. There's a very beautiful result in conformal field theory in 1 plus 1 dimensions. So this is a result totally independent from ADS CFT. So this was just calculated in a quantum field theory with a density matrix using the so-called replica trick. And so due to Cardi and Calabrese. And they showed that if you have any conformal field theory in 1 plus 1 dimensions, then this is the result which they get. I mean, this is a very short result here, but if you look at the paper, this is a pretty elaborate calculation in quantum field theory. Because you have to go take this replica trick and, you know, look at different sheets and take a limit, and it's really quite involved. But the final result is quite simple. So this little L is a typical size of the region. So for instance, you could consider a strip in this one plus one dimensional field theory. C is the central charge of the conformal field theory. And then lambda is some cutoff. I mean, okay, so there are some issues about divergences. So certainly you have to have a UV regulator in this result. Okay, and this is exactly reproduced by the Ryotaka-Inagi result if you go to the case where the field theory is in 1 plus 1 dimensions. And if we identify this cutoff with a 1 over epsilon, and epsilon is just a cutoff, maybe I should just quickly draw a picture. So this is something which is very often done in ADS CFT. So again, if this is our ADS space, and then we have a boundary of ADS, and this is our radial coordinate. So now, since this distance is infinite, you know, there's a tendency of infinities showing up in your calculations. So, and what is generally done is that we cut off at some small epsilon. Okay, so this is an epsilon. And then this epsilon is used as a regulator. So this leads to a concept called holographic renormalization. And this is a well elaborate concept where you can calculate finite quantities using the ADS CFT correspondence. And certainly, okay, so this quantity needs a regulator. And in our case, this will be 1 over epsilon with the epsilon defined in this way. Okay, so the central charge, if you are in ADS CFT in 1 plus 1 dimensions, will be given by the ADS radius divided by the three-dimensional Newton constant. So you can show that this is precisely the central charge of your quantum field theory. Okay, so this is a exact result. There are subleading terms which don't appear in the large N limit. But if you calculate the surface, the area of the surface, just as I said for ADS3, then you get exactly this result. So that's already very non-trivial that this matches. And so you can also do this at finite temperature, and then the result looks like this. So the temperature appears here. Okay, so this is very well understood in 1 plus 1 dimensions. And let me quickly show one result which I got my student Nina Miklai. So Nina, she is extremely good at handling complicated generalized functions. And so she managed to get an analytic expression in closed form for a strict region for arbitrary dimensions. Okay, so you don't have to understand the details of this formula. So the key point of this formula, it's an analytic closed form expression. Okay, it involves higher order, higher polygeometric functions. All these things, there are some kind of coefficients. And then this Z star is the turning point of the minimal surface, which again is also given implicitly in terms of the strip width, which is again this little L. Okay, and the interesting thing is, in quantum field theory, it's not known how to calculate this in more than 1+1 dimensions. But now there's an ADS CFT prediction for this, and I, potentially this might also be interesting for QCD. it's certainly an interesting question if we can use entanglement to learn more about QCD. Okay, so rather than explaining all the terms, let me just plot this function, okay? I'll just show you a plot. So this curve is exactly the same. I'm just plotting this expression for different values of the dimension. Though to get something finite, we regularized in the following way, and that we consider the so-called entanglement density, which essentially is the entanglement entropy at finite temperature minus the entanglement entropy at zero temperature divided by the volume of the entangling region. Okay, and then on this line you have the width of the strip which you are considering times the temperature, and here you have this entanglement entropy density in units of the thermal entropy density. Okay, and something very interesting happens, which is not understood. So if you are in three dimensions, this is the curve. So this is three means in the field theory, 2+1 dimensional field theory. So QCD would be four dimensions, so this line. And then suddenly if you go to more than six dimensions, this curve gets a maximum, it's non-monotonic. Now there's something called the area theorem in quantum field theory, which tells you that this function has to be monotonic. Okay, it's a kind of, maybe some of you know the so-called C theorem. So this is a theorem which tells you that along RG flows there has to be a monotonic behavior, and this area theorem is a bit similar expression for the entanglement entropy. So the fact that there's a maximum here means that there's something wrong with the quantum field theory. Okay, but okay, we don't exactly know what the problem is, but it just tells you that in more than six dimensions, it's not really clear what the quantum field theory is. But that's consistent with the fact that if you are in seven dimensions, it means your gravity dual would be an ADS-8 space. But there are no known consistent solutions of supergravity which involve an ADS-8. So this could mean that, so you have to add some stringy modes or, I mean, anyway, in these high dimensions, it's not possible to write down Lagrangians as a series become non-renormalizable anyway. So it's a bit hard to say what goes wrong, but it is an interesting fact, which is a prediction from this large dimension calculation. Anyway, so but for QCD, then we just have this green line, so everything should be fine. Nevertheless, I think this is something which deserves some study if we can learn anything from QCD or from this entanglement engine. And so here you see one of the virtues of ADS-CFT, because we can easily extend a calculation to arbitrary dimensions, which in quantum field theory can only be done in 1+1 dimension. Okay, so that concludes my overview of some interesting features of ADS-CFT, and now I would like to return to this question which I asked at the beginning. Can we generalize ADS-CFT to quantum field theories of experimental relevance? And of course, the prototype candidate, which I think most of the audience is interested in, is low energy QCD. Okay. So, obviously, if we would like to describe low energy QCD, we have to generalize our ADS-CFT correspondence. And one thing is, I emphasize so much that this NX24 theory has a huge amount of symmetry. And of course, the symmetry is not present in QCD. So if we want to study something more QCD-like, we have to break these symmetries. And so this means we have to relax the symmetry requirements in a controlled way. One possibility is, say, is to add a relevant operator to generate a randomization loop flows. Okay, so this we will certainly do in the subsequent. And then something very important needs to be added, because so far in NX24 super young Mills, everything transforms in the adjoint representation of the gauge group, which means we don't have any quark-like degrees of freedom. So what we need to do is to introduce quarks into the ADS-CFT correspondence, and I will show you how this can be done. Okay, one important point to remember is that the large N limit continues to apply. So as I explained already in my very first lecture on Tuesday, it's not possible easily to undo this limit, because then you have to include quantum corrections on the gravity side. And that's something not very well defined at present. I mean, you can look at 1/n corrections, so maybe one or two orders. But this is a complicated thing to do. So this means everything I'm going to say in the subsequent will still apply to large N. Okay, we have to live with that. I mean, of course, QCD has SU3, not SUN. But okay, so the error in general will be 1/n², which is about 10% if n is equal to 3. Okay. Large N is a well-known approximation method for calculating Feynman diagrams in QCD. Well, it's true that large N QCD has different features. For instance, this anomaly, which I showed to you earlier for the vorticity, this goes away in large N QCD. So some features of large N QCD are definitely different from standard QCD. But okay, it's a since anyway, low energy QCD is an unsolved problem, it's good to have another perspective for looking at it. Okay, so this means we have to generalize our ADS-CFT correspondence to more general examples of gauge gravity duality. So this means we have to break, so our original NX24 theory was conformally invariant and supersymmetric, so both of which properties don't appear in real QCD. So we have to break both the conformal symmetry and the supersymmetry. Now, I hope you remember from my lectures before, the conformal symmetry of the quantum field theory is dual to the isometries of the anti-de Sitter space, whereas the supersymmetry was realized by the symmetries of this internal sphere, this S5. Okay, so if we want to break both the conformal symmetry and the supersymmetry, we have to deform both the anti-de Sitter space and the S5. Okay, so essentially this means we have to look at more complicated solutions of supergravity theories and also take more general supergravity action. And essentially, just as a cartoon, it means we don't get our super beautiful symmetric anti-de Sitter spacetime anymore, but we get something squeezed and complicated. Okay, so I'm just squeezing the space and then I have less symmetries. And so something very interesting then happens in the sense that this fifth dimension, remember the boundary is here, this is our Minkowski space, that's where our quantum field theory lives. And now this extra dimension, which I add, can then be interpreted as an energy scale. So this means if I'm close to the boundary, I'm in the UV, and if I flow to the interior, I'll be in the infrared. And so the fact that we have different values of this dimension then just means we are at different energy scales. That's a very nice concept. And so in the early 2000s, there were many examples where people studied deformed versions of ADS-CFT to propose new backgrounds, which have properties closer to that of QCD. So similarly, if we want to break the supersymmetry, then we have to disform this S5 sphere and squash it to something less symmetric. Okay. Now let me come to this topic of introducing quarks into the ADS-CFT correspondence. So let me first introduce the quarks for the original ADS-5 times S5, and then later the idea will be to combine this together with this deformation. Okay. Okay, the simplest, I mean, there's different ways of doing this, and let me start with one which is rather simple. So I told you that the original ADS-CFT correspondence comes from considering n V3 brains in the directions 0, 1, 2, and 3. Okay. And now, as I explain in the next slides, the way you can introduce quarks is by putting more different brains. So in particular, the so-called D7 brains. So these are 8-dimensional surfaces. So you add them into the 10-dimensional space. Okay, so here we see our 10 coordinates, and then we have the D3 brains here, and now say I take, so we have n D3 brains, and n is a very large number which goes to infinity. And for simplicity, let's just take one or two of these D7 brains, which means that we have one or two flavors of quarks. So either we just have up, or we have up and down quarks. Okay. So, and this D7 brain is an object which has 7 space in 1 time direction, so it will span all of these directions. So actually, as I'm going to explain to you now on the next slide, the quarks correspond, remember yesterday I explained to you that the open strings give rise to the gauge fields. But now the quarks, they will correspond to the low energy limit. So the low energy limit will be very similar to the one we were discussing yesterday of open strings between the D3 and the D7 brains. Okay. So again, if this is my cartoon of anti-de Sitter space, and this is the S5. Now, what I will put this blue surface, which first is going to fill all of this anti-de Sitter space, but it's also going to fill an S3 within the S5. And then this can, so there's 2 empty directions, which you see here. Okay. So this brain can actually fluctuate now. And the fluctuations here, they will be fluctuations in these 2 directions, because they're perpendicular to this D7 brain. And I will show to you in a second that the eigenvalues of these fluctuations, they will actually correspond to the meson masses in your theory. Okay, first let me explain why the quarks correspond to the low energy limit of open strings between the D3 and the D7 brain. Okay. I don't want, okay, about 50 slides ago, let me just say quickly, I drew you this figure. Let me, so I had this figure of the D3 brains, and there was this open string picture, and then on the other hand, we had this picture with the near horizon limit where there were these closed string excitations. Okay, so again, here we are. These are all V3 brains, and then I explained the duality given that you take this particular low energy limit. Okay, so that's what I explained yesterday. So now this duality in the simplest case will still be there, but because I need more dimensions, I mean, it's very hard to draw 10 dimensions on a 2-dimensional surface. So I'm going to turn them around such that we just see them as a black line. Okay, so in this figure, the dimensions 0, 1, 2, 3 go up. Okay, 4, 5, 6, 7 goes in this direction, and 8 and 9 points towards you. And this means these NV3 brains in this figure, which I discussed yesterday in great detail, they will appear as this black line here. Okay, because they stretch in a 0, 1, 2, 3 direction. And now the LES-CFT correspondence we were discussing before is a relation between these green open strings and those green closed strings. Okay, so on this side, this is the open string field theory picture, and this is the closed string gravity picture again, where I have just drawn the ADS5 space. I mean, I should also have drawn this S5 again. So really, you should consider this picture being on the right-hand side of this graph. Okay, there's also the S5 is also here. Okay, so here I wrote conventional open closed string duality. So this duality is exactly the same as I've been talking about for the entire week. Now something new happens because we put this extra V7 probe brain. So this is this blue rectangle. And that stretches, so going back to this picture, it stretches in the 0, 1, 2, 3, but also in the 4, 5, 6, 7 directions. So this means on this graph, it stretches in the 0, 1, 2, 3, but also in the 4, 5, 6, 7 direction. So that's why it appears as a kind of rectangle. So remember, we just take a small amount. And now, okay, so if we take the number of these blue additional brains to be small, then we are in the so-called probe approximation. And then we can neglect the back reaction of these additional brains on the original ADS geometry and just consider this blue brain embedded in this curved space background of consisting of ADS 5 and S5. And so in a very nice paper, Karchen Katz in 2002 conjectured that now actually the duality will act twice. So first we have the same duality as before, which was that NX4 SUN super Young-Wiss theory is dual to type 2B supergravity on ADS 5 times S5. So this is what I explained to you in the last three lectures. But now this will be coupled to, first of all, in this case, the supersymmetric matter. But matter which will be in the fundamental representation of our SUN gauge group. So it will be like quarks, okay? Because you just remember the difference between a quark and a gluon. So if you have a field in the adjoint representation, well, maybe I should draw it like this. If you have, yesterday I had these fields phi, which were in this adjoint representation. So this means the gauge transformation of these fields is that looks like this. Okay. Now I will introduce some quark fields, and they will, so this is the adjoint representation. And these quark fields, they will transform in this way, which is the fundamental. Representation. Okay, so this is what we want to have. And now this blue rectangle allows me to introduce open strings, which will represent fields which transform precisely in this way. And these are denoted by this red line in this graph. Okay, so now I have an open string which starts on the D3 brain, but instead of ending again on the D3 brain, it will end on this D7 brain. So there will, you know, it will go a distance between the two. And remember, so the strings have charged endpoints, and the fact that these green strings lead to these adjoint. This adjoint behavior is related to the fact that the two endpoints are on the same stack of brains. But now this red string, which goes from the D3 to the D7 brains, has one endpoint on the D3, but one endpoint on the D7 brain. And so this means, on one hand side, it will transform just in the way I have written here. But in the other hand, it will be in the anti-fundamental of this gauge group under the seven brain. Yeah, you want to ask a question?
Strings?
I will come to them in a second. I mean, the thing is that everything else which I haven't drawn decouples, so we can ignore it. Okay, because we take this particular limit again. So at first, so have an object which transforms in the fundamental of this 3 plus 1 dimensional theory, and it transforms in the anti-fundamental of this 7 plus 1 dimensional theory. However, in 7 plus 1 dimensions, the gauge coupling is dimensionful. And now the interesting point is that if I take this Malacena limit, where I take n d3 brains with n going to infinity, but I take just a very small number of these d7 brains, then actually this gauge symmetry becomes a global symmetry because the 8-dimensional gauge coupling goes to 0. So if the 8-dimensional gauge coupling goes to 0, this just becomes a global symmetry. And so this symmetry will be the flavor symmetry of my walks. Okay, so as you just asked, there are many other strings which you could have. But in this limit, since the gauge coupling in 8-dimension goes to 0, they will all disappear. You don't have to consider them. However, there will be 7-7 strings on this side of the duality, on the gravity side. Okay. And actually, these 7-7 strings, they will be described again by the Dirac-Bohn-Infeld action, which I wrote for the D3 brain yesterday. But now it will be the Dirac-Bohn-Infeld action for these D7 brains. And so this Dirac-Bohn-Infeld action will describe how the brain fluctuates in these empty directions. So these open strings here, they describe the fluctuations of the brain in the directions transverse to them. Okay, so as Kachin-Katznen conjectured, the duality acts twice. So we have the original duality which we have before. But now on top of this, we will have these fundamental fields, and their degrees of freedom will be dual to the fluctuations of this blue brain inside this 10-dimensional space. And these fluctuations will be given by the Dirac-Bohn-Infeld action for this D7 brain. So it's the same type of action I was discussing yesterday for the D3 brains, but now for the D7 brain. Okay, if you have never seen this, this will be quite hard to understand. So do you have any questions about this? Okay, let me go. Yeah? No, okay, that's a good question, and I will come back to that this afternoon. In this case, you don't have any non-abelian flavor symmetry. I mean, okay. If you want a product of two symmetries, you need brains and anti-brains. But if you do that with the D7 brains, you cannot. There's no configuration, stable configuration where you can put them.
Oh, so there are only brains, no anti-brains here.
Yeah, there's okay. You're thinking of this accessory motor model, but this is something. I mean, this is a toy model. Okay, I will come to the accessory motor this afternoon. So there's no. So what your colleague is asking is, can we realize the SUNF times SUNF flavor symmetry of QCD in this model, and the answer is no, but there's another model where it's actually possible, and I will tell about this afternoon. But nevertheless, let me stay with this model for a while, because many very interesting things can be done here. Yeah. Okay. So let me very quickly say, so maybe this answers your question also, what is the field theory which we describe with this brain construction. So, as I said, quarks are introduced into ADS-CFT via the addition of brain probes, and so far I just take the case of one flavor. Later I might say a few things about having two flavors. In any case, the number of flavors should be much smaller than the number of colors, because then you can neglect the Buck reaction, and then we have just a crow brain, nothing which changes the geometry. Okay, so and as I argued on this previous slide, is that the open strings between the D3 brains and the brain probe correspond to fundamental degrees of freedom in the field theory, just as here. Okay, so essentially the field theory which we describe in this way is a gauge theory, an SUN gauge theory, where you have now some quark fields. Yeah, in the simple model, essentially it's just one flavor, quark fields. And so these are in the fundamental now of this SUN gauge group. And in fact, now this theory will possess a U1 axial symmetry, as I discussed earlier already today, because we have essentially two Dirac fermions, a left one and a right hand one, and they transform in this way. Okay. So, and this U1 axial symmetry is realized by rotations in these empty directions here. And so now what I would be able to show to you that in this model we can actually have a gravity dual of chiral symmetry breaking, so it's something one should be familiar with from QCD. And in fact, there will be a spontaneous symmetry breaking by a condensate, which involves precisely this field psi. Okay, so this is what I would like to show to you next. Well, exactly. That's a very good point. So, in large N QCD, so the Goldstein boson is going to be the eta prime particle, which in real QCD is obviously not massless, and that's due to the fact that you have an SU3 gauge symmetry. So there's an anomaly which affects the mass of this particle. But if we are in a large N theory, the coefficient of this anomaly vanishes, and then your eta prime particle is a true Goldstein boson. Yeah. Yeah, very good question. So here we can see that something very special about this large N limit will enter the physics. Okay, so what I'm going to show to you, well, I guess after the lunch break, is how we can now describe chiral symmetry breaking for the quarks which we introduced in our model. And so essentially, then once we have this chiral symmetry breaking, the question is, do we have Goldstein bosons? If we have spontaneous symmetry breaking, there should be Goldstein bosons. And then indeed, we will see them, and we can also realize them geometrically. And then we can look at fluctuations about our new background. And indeed, we can calculate the energy eigenvalues of these fluctuations. Okay, here it's shown for ADS5 times S5, so these are some somewhat exotic supersymmetric mesons. But if we do this to this more QCD-like series, we actually see some properties of mesons which you expect from QCD. And in fact, you can have a pi meson and a rho meson. So, okay, I mean, to zeroth order, I would consider this eta prime similar to this pi meson. So it's a pseudo-scalar meson. And this we will get from the energy eigenvalues of the seven brain coordinate fluctuations. And we can also have a rho mesons, and there the masses will come from the energy eigenvalues of the gauge field fluctuations on the seven brains. So remember that I said that these seven brains are charged, so you can have gauge fields on them. And so they can fluctuate, and they also have energy eigenvalues. So, and then what I'll do after the lunch break is I will show to you how to get this background where we have confinement in chiral symmetry breaking, and then look at these fluctuations, and then calculate the masses of the pi and rho mesons, and make some comparison to lattice gauge theory. And I think what is very interesting, what I can show you, that so we can do a calculation of these meson masses in ADS-CFT, and if you believe everything I said so far, this calculation can be done with Mathematica in one afternoon on your laptop. And the lattice gauge calculations we compared to was done by a group of seven lattice gauge theorists with a supercomputer, and they took 6 months to do the computation. So it's quite interesting that we can compare these two things together, and this will be one of the highlights I hope I will show you after the break, that we can really compare these two things and it matches quite well. Okay, that was
okay. Can you just tell something about the coordinate fluctuations? What exactly you mean?
Yeah, okay, okay, this is what exactly what I want to show you after that. But okay, so let me show quickly. Okay, so what I'm going to have is that we have these seven rains, and there's two directions perpendicular to them, and so they can fluctuate in these directions. Yeah, so after lunch, I write down the coordinates and we'll see this exactly. Okay, I think I have 20 seconds, so I can probably 18, 17. Okay, so I think we can go to questions. All right, thanks a lot. So further questions? Yeah. How do I get different flavors? Well, the different flavors will be gotten by just not just taking one brain, but two of these brains, for instance, on top of each other. Then you get, an SU2 flavor symmetry. And then there's some elaborate models where you have brains and anti-brains. Then you can have the full SUNF times SUNF symmetry. But the short answer is you take, if you want two flavors, you have to take two of the D7 brains. Then it becomes immediately more difficult because then you have a non-abelian gauge theory in the gravity side rather than an abelian one, and then usually life becomes much harder. But I wrote quite a few papers where we at least had two brains on top of each other, and then with an SU2 symmetry, there's still many things you can actually do. So where somehow the non-abelian structure is under control such that you can truncate the expansion, that's important. Yeah, but it's true, life gets hot.
Now you're going to show us for two flavors, right? Is it for two flavors or?
Yeah, I will show you results for two flavors. Good. Also. Yeah.
But you already had, you already had N of, or you have?
So far I had one.
I mean, you're taking probe limit here, so.
I think, well, for everything in what I'm going to tell you, I'm going to take either one or two of these seven brains and stick with
it. I see.
Because, I should say there's also quite a lot of work where people took NF, these seven brains, and took NF the same order of magnitude as N. This also is very interesting, but if you do that, then these blue surfaces, they will affect the geometry. Okay, so then if you put these blue surfaces, it will become, their mass will become of the same order as the background. So then they will start back reacting and deforming the background, and that becomes extremely complicated. I mean, there's some very brave people that did some very, very good calculations for this, but I don't think I will show this today. I mean, this becomes very, very involved.
So you're saying that this the deformation that you're talking about, that could happen if you take more of them. So that would happen even in probe limit.
This will even happen in the probe limit, yeah. Yeah, so we can see the chirosymmetry breaking even in the probe limit. Yes.
Yeah, low energy limit of the D3-D7 system. So the massive modes of these strings expanding between, will that survive?
Essentially, it will decouple, but certainly. So the mass of the quark is related to the distance between D3 and the D7 range. So this is a result from string theory.
Right.
So this means if we, if they're just on top of each other like here, then the mass is zero of the quark. But if you start separating them, you have two directions where you can separate the D7 from the D3, and then of course.
Yeah, that gives the mass, but now when you look at the low energy limit, it's probably the separation says that the massive moves still survive. Is that correct? Because you are again going to look at the low energy limit of the entire system, right?
Okay, the mass, the string excitation for massive moves will still decouple as before. But there will be a way of introducing the quark mass.
Okay.
If not, let's thank Johanna again, and we'll go for lunch.